So the first human had gone to space and ushered in the era of humans in space, which is the main topic of our collaboration video series with the Total Space Network. From Yuri Gagarin in 1961, 60 years ago incredibly, to today, only 568 people have ever been to space. 568 out of 7.85 billion people. So we still have a very long way to go until we can call ourselves a space-faring civilization, or until we can use the word space age without embarrassing ourselves. Anyways, after Yuri Gagarin's first epic journey to space, the US, of course, wasn't sleeping. This was another first for the Soviets, and it really didn't sit well with the Americans. So they increased their efforts with their space program even more. We mentioned the X-15 space plane project before, and that it was decided to be replaced by a ballistic capsule instead for sending the first man to space. NASA named this new project Mercury, and already on the 5th of May 1961, Alan Shepard became the first American in space aboard the Mercury capsule Freedom 7, launched on a 15-minute suborbital flight. So even though the Americans now also had sent a man to space, the flight path was far less impressive than Gagarin's circling of the entire Earth with Vostok 1. It was only on February 20, 1962, that John Glenn completed 3 Earth orbits, finally surpassing Gagarin's flight trajectory aboard his vessel Friendship 7. The pinnacle was then L. Gordon Cooper's flight, with Faith 7 on May 15th and 16th, 1963, where he circled the Earth 22 times. But of course, meanwhile, the Soviets had another first, namely the first woman in space, Valentina Tereshkova with Vostok 6. She is still alive, by the way. The Russian achievements during that time are really nothing short of astounding. One first after another, and they still weren't done yet with the firsts, because they were already preparing for their new Vostok program, the second Soviet human spaceflight project. The Vostok spacecraft was basically a Vostok spacecraft that had a backup, solid-fueled retro rocket added to the top of the descent module and allowed for a crew size of 2. It was launched on still a modified version of the same R-7 ICBM rocket that launched Sputnik 1. The Vostok only carried out 3 missions, one in 1964 and one in 1965 with humans, and then a 22-day long mission in 1966, but only with 2 dogs instead of humans. Believe it or not, the dogs actually survived. And the Soviets had yet another first on March 18, 1965 with Vostok 2. Here, Alexei Leonov performed the first spacewalk. But even though this was another impressive achievement for the Soviets, it nearly ended in disaster.
During the spacewalk, Leonov's spacesuit started ballooning, making movement for him very difficult. He couldn't even reach his camera to take pictures of the Earth. But the real problem began when he wanted to re-enter the airlock. Due to the ballooning of his spacesuit, he got stuck and couldn't proceed further. He then had to decompress his suit so that he could move again, which was of course very dangerous. He just barely managed to get inside the spacecraft to his co-pilot Belyayev. Of course, these difficulties were covered up by the Soviet propaganda, and this all came to light only much later. But the West was seriously not only starting to catch up, but the time came to overtake the Soviets, in large part also due to some bad decisions from the Soviet political command, who approved the Soviet moon program far too late in 1964, 3 years after the start of the Apollo program. Meanwhile, in the US, the Gemini missions were underway. Gemini was the American version of Vostok, a space capsule quite a lot larger than the Mercury capsule that was able to seat 2 astronauts. Gemini's objective was clear: to develop space travel techniques in order to take over the lead in the space race and ultimately to support the Apollo moon program. The Apollo moon program had in fact been approved as early as 1961 and was already 3 years in when the first Gemini test flight took place on April 8, 1964. But the first manned mission was launched on March 23, 1965, only 5 days after Alexei Leonov's nearly disastrous first ever spacewalk. The mission was Gemini 3, and astronauts Gus Grissom and John Young flew three Earth orbits in their spacecraft nicknamed Molly Brown. But no spacewalk was yet carried out. This was only the 9th manned US spaceflight if you take into account two flights over the Kármán line with the X-15 and just the 17th human spaceflight, including the 8 Soviet spaceflights until that date. Interestingly, this was also the last time that Mission Control was in Cape Kennedy Air Force Station in Florida. After Gemini 3, Mission Control was shifted to the new control center in Houston, Texas. All Gemini missions were launched with the Titan II rocket, which was, as in the case of the Soviet Vostok and Vostok missions, a modified intercontinental ballistic missile.
The first American spacewalk was then carried out with Gemini 4, where Ed White became the first American to make that extravehicular activity, or EVA, as a spacewalk is called in technical terms. This was on June 3, 1965. 2.5 months after Leonov's spacewalk. Gemini 5 demonstrated the capability to remain in space for 8 days from August 21st until August 29th. This was the time necessary for an entire Apollo mission duration, and the purpose of Gemini was to prepare for Apollo. It was also the first time where fuel cells were being used to generate electrical power. Gemini 6A and 7 accomplished the first space rendezvous in December 1965. Gemini 8 accomplished the first space docking. Gemini 10 established that radiation was not a showstopper. Gemini 11 performed the first direct ascent rendezvous, docking with an Agenda-type target vehicle only 1 hour and 34 minutes after launch, a record that stands until this very day. And on the final Gemini mission, Gemini 12, Buzz Aldrin became the first spacewalker to prove that useful work could actually be done during a spacewalk without encountering exhaustion. This was on November 11, 1966. Thus, the Gemini project came to an end, as it had fulfilled its objective of demonstrating all necessary technologies and capabilities in order to carry out the moon landings with the later Apollo missions. By 1966, the Apollo program was already quite far, but we will talk about that in more detail in the second part of this collaboration over on Total Space Network. Meanwhile, the Soviets were busy preparing for their own version of the Gemini program, which they called Soyuz, translated as Union. The Soyuz spacecraft was quite a lot larger than even the Vostok capsule, allowing for a crew size of up to 3 cosmonauts. The spacecraft consists of 3 modules: an orbital module, where the cosmonauts are seated during orbiting operations; a re-entry module, where the cosmonauts are seated during the re-entry process upon return to Earth; and then the service and propulsion module that generates power and propels the spacecraft. The first iteration, known as Soyuz 7K, had already started development as early as in 1963 and was actually intended to carry the cosmonauts to lunar orbit in preparation for manned moon landings. Sergei Korolev initially planned the Soyuz circumlunar complex, in which the Soyuz 7K would rendezvous with the other components in low Earth orbit, assemble a lunar excursion vehicle, and then travel to the moon. The whole mission duration would have been 7 to 8 days, and they would have flown around the moon at a distance of up to 1,000 kilometers. But unfortunately, this mission never happened. It was cancelled in mid-1964 due to delays, and also because the Soviet leadership decided to aim for a direct moon landing instead. It's fascinating to think about that the Soviets could have already circled the moon as early as in 1965 or 1966. That might have sent another shockwave to the West. The Soyuz craft that actually flew during that time was the Soyuz 7K-OK, cool name by the way, which flew from 1967 until 1970. It underwent many evolutionary steps and is still in use up to this day. But unfortunately, the first flight of this first real Soyuz variant was a disaster. Soyuz 1 was launched into orbit on April 23, 1967, with cosmonaut Vladimir Komarov. On this first manned mission with Soyuz, Komarov completed 18 Earth orbits in a mission duration of a bit more than one day. However, upon re-entry, the parachute failed and the spacecraft crashed into the ground with high velocity, claiming the life of Vladimir Komarov. This was the first in-flight fatality in the history of spaceflight, and sadly occurred only 3 months after the tragic Apollo 1 fire that claimed the life of all three Apollo 1 astronauts. Humanity had only flown to space for 6 years by that time, but already now, our first ventures into space had claimed 4 lives.
After that tragic event, Soyuz 2 was delayed for quite a long time, and only 1.5 years later did it launch on October 25th, 1968. Only one day later, Soyuz 3 was launched, carrying cosmonaut Georgi Beregovoy into space. He completed an astounding 81 orbits and stayed in low Earth orbit for 3 days and 22 hours. The mission goal was to perform a docking maneuver with Soyuz 2 in orbit. However, upon nearing Soyuz 2, Beregovoy noticed too late that the craft was turned upside down in relation to his spacecraft, and by that time he had already used up too much fuel. But this failure was of course kept secret in good old Soviet fashion and came out much later after the collapse of the Soviet Union. But he landed safely back on Earth on October 30th, 1968. However, by that time, the United States were already carrying out Apollo 7, the first manned Apollo mission since the tragic accident of Apollo 1 in early 1967. It became all but clear now that the Russians were losing the race to the moon. But they continued their Soyuz program. Soyuz 4 was launched on January 14, 1969 with cosmonaut Vladimir Shatalov on board. The mission was to dock with Soyuz 5, which was launched separately one day later with 3 cosmonauts on board. And the docking was successful. The 2 spacecraft docked on January 16th. This was the last first for the Soviet manned space program, because it was the first successful docking of 2 spacecraft in low Earth orbit. Apollo 9 would carry out the first successful docking for the American side 2 months later in March 1969. The space race ended with the first Apollo moon landing in July 1969, about which our friends from the Total Space Network will talk in much more detail in the next episode of this collaborative series. So be sure to check out their channel and their podcast, because the next episode will be aired next week.
So this is the second video of our collaboration with the Total Space Network on the topic of humans in space.
We'd like to thank the awesome people from their channel, and especially the ones we work together with more closely. These are Rich LB, Miko, another space nut, and Kage.
And don't forget to check out the next video on our collaboration on their YouTube channel. Or you can also listen to their podcast.
So then, thanks for watching the JS Space Report, and I would say, on to the future.